Select Board to order on Monday, March 25th, 2024, at 6:30 p.m. Please join me in saluting the flag. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Let the record show all select now present. Consent agenda. Letter C, AP warrant number 23-226-24, number 24-226-24, number 25-312-24, payroll register number 8-322-24, number 229-24, number 10-37-24, number 11-314-24, and number 12-321-24. Looking for a motion to approve.
Make a motion to approve also for the AP warrant and payroll registers as presented.
All right, we have a motion and a second to approve the payroll registers and AP warrants as read. Any questions? Seeing none, all those in favor? All in favor, the motion carries. Apparently there's no letter D, so we'll move on to letter E. Acceptance of the minutes of the select board meeting on February 26, 2024.
Make a motion to accept the minutes from February 26, 2024.
I have a motion and a second to accept the minutes of the select board meeting on February 26, 2024. Any questions? Seeing none, all those in favor? All in favor, the motion carries. Old business. To appoint a new member to the Budget Advisory Board. Tom Manager, you have a name for us.
I'd like to nominate Jeff Lloyd. I've asked him. He said he's interested and he would serve if nominated.
Okay. Looking for a motion to approve Jeff Lloyd.
I'll make a motion that we approve Jeff Lloyd.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second to appoint Jeff Lloyd to the Budget Advisory Board. Any questions? Seeing none, all those in favor? All in favor, the motion carries.
I'll let him know.
Budget timeline adjusted to move the joint work session from school vacation week. So, Town Manager, what are you suggesting here?
I'm suggesting that we have an initial budget review tonight with the board, and then Monday, April 8th, we invite the advisory board to join us. And then as of Tuesday, April 15th, that we make sure that the budget packets go out to the advisory board. Members, and that we have our joint meeting with the Budget Advisory Committee and the Board of Selectmen on May 1st and May 2nd as needed. And you should have gotten one in your packet.
So what happened to May, what happened to April 3rd?
There was no way I was going to be ready.
Okay. I will not be here April 8th, so.
Okay.
You can go home without me. Don't worry about it.
Okay.
As long as everybody else is going to be here. Okay, so April 8th is going to be, let's just restate those so we can.
Okay. So April 8th will be inviting the advisory board members and the department heads to the Board of Selectmen meeting for preliminary budget discussions.
Okay. All right. And April 15th will be?
The budget packets will be mailed to the advisory board members based on any changes that may have been presented during the initial review. And then the joint work session meeting with the Board of Selectmen and the Budget Advisory Committee will take place Wednesday, May 1st, and then Thursday, May 2nd, if needed.
Okay. All right, any questions on that from the board? Okay, and you'll get that out to everybody?
I will.
All right, out of the communication from, we have department reports of ACO, the CEO, which is here, fire, highway, library, recreation, and sheriff. Jeff, do you have anything you want to go over, or are you happy with your report as written?
Oh, I'm happy with that report, but I got other stuff.
Okay, what are you?
You want to take it up under new business or under his CEO now? I didn't have it under new business, so I just I put it in there as part of his report.
Yeah, let's talk about it.
Okay.
Okay, okay. 88 County Golf Course Road. We have some folks here in the audience. They have a I sent papers, code violation. The house is, part of the house is a kind of a shed that there's some residents in there, but it's collapsing. You can see a significant sag in the roof. If you care to see the pictures.
Did you make extra copies for me?
It's structurally not sound. Those pictures were taken Friday right after the snowstorm. You can see that there's no insulation in there because all the snow is melted right off. It is a non-permitted build. The septic system for that wasn't, that's not conforming with the current septic system on there, so.
What you're looking for us is to condemn this addition block.
It needs to be condemned. The problem is there's somebody living in it, and they're pretty much squatting.
Process for that?
Well, that'll be up to the property owner to remove them. But I can condemn the house or the part of that structure. There's also a chicken coop and a shed that are within the 15-foot setback of the property line. It's just bad news all around.
Okay, what do you need from us?
Property owner is here.
Do they want to?
Have anything you want to add to this?
I want to be in complete compliance with the town. I don't want to. I'm not fighting this. It needs to happen. The occupants in it are elderly, and they don't know enough that they need to go. It's not safe for them. I'm surprised it's lasted the winter. And I've gone to court once to try to evict them, and they tried to lay claim to the building because they haven't paid me rent for X amount of years because it was my mother. So she's 72, she's on disability. Richard's had four strokes, he's had open heart surgery. They would never be able to fix that building and maintain it. They just need to move. And I don't want, I want to be back in compliance with the town. And I know it's got to come down.
So if we vote today to condemn that, that turns back into the property owner to get the person out, and we're not going to go in and tear it down.
Correct. No, that's up to him.
I've already set up a plan with Jeff to take the building down. I've got DJ Manter. He'll come over with his picker and put it right to a roll-off dumpster. It'll be down as soon as I get the personal items out of it. And put them into storage for them. I'll take it right down.
Mr. Moody.
What's the time frame?
Whatever's best for the town.
Getting them out.
I just have to have time. If you guys condemn the building completely, then I have to have my lawyer, or I don't know how that works, the sheriff's department, somebody, get them out so that we can take the building down. It'll take me less than 2 weeks.
Once we get them out.
And the two outbuildings can be moved at the same time. So they won't be within the 15-foot setback of Jay McLaughlin's property.
All right, so looking for a motion to condemn this building at 88 Golf Course Road. Motion?
So moved.
I'll make a motion to condemn 88 Golf Course, yeah.
Okay, second, Mr. Moody?
Yeah.
All right, we got a motion and a second to condemn
a portion
of this, of the house at 88 Golf Course Road.
The addition part of that.
Is that correct? Is that
correct?
Yeah. All right, any other questions?
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Jeff, did you give the names of the property owners and I missed it?
No, you just said you didn't.
I did not. They're Kevin Lombard and...
Kevin Lombard. I'm the only one on the deed.
Okay, thank you.
All right. Any other questions? Seeing none, all those in favor? All right, all in favor, the motion carries. All right, anything else, Ed?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Sorry, I'm just pulling it tonight. It's been a year since the last update of our fee structure. And there are some that, to the most part, everything is right on the money in comparison to other towns. Some are a little higher, some are a little lower, but to the most part, we're right even. What I'm seeing is a lot of solar going in on residential structures. That's not in our fee structure. Now, there is a section that says other, but it's only 10 cents a square foot. There's minimums for residential, which is $25. Minimum for commercial is 75. It's still 10 cents a square foot. A 440 square foot is, $44 for residential, where the 55 Weston Ave, they're each 660 square feet. That minimum is $75. These are popping up everywhere. We don't have it in our fee structure.
So these are solar hooked onto a house?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so what would you like to see that be?
That's up to the select board.
Well, I mean, you gotta give us some idea.
Right, have you gone, done any research from other towns?
That's just it. There's nothing for other towns.
There's a wide range.
A very wide range, because it's so newish, and no one's added it to their fee structure.
All right, so I guess what I will ask you to do is to go back and research that a little bit more and come up with what you think you could recommend to us, whatever it may be.
Mm-hmm.
We're really shooting in the dark on that.
So like the range even.
Right.
Are there any towns out there that we know of that like-sized was that have fees set up?
Well, Pittsfield has a pretty big solar field. I don't know if they've got fees scheduled or not on that. Did you hear anything back from Pittsfield?
No.
This is different from that,
oh,
right?
Yeah, this is just
somebody's house.
Oh, okay, sorry.
I didn't know if we'd have anything in southwestern Maine, some of the small towns.
I can ask again, but.
Yeah, I would say if you could get some direction on how much you think that the fee should be, I think we'll go along with whatever you say, as long as they're not outrageous. But
right.
I don't have any knowledge of what it should be, or what would be considered too much.
Do we have a fee for the solar fields that we have? Are there fees for that?
We did that under
under
new construction.
Oh, okay.
That was 20 cents a square foot.
So that part's been taken care of. We just need the residential to be added on.
Yeah, I've been. I have it listed so far under accessory structure. Accessory structure says shed, pool, deck, porch, etc. I've been using the etc. But it's not clear. It's clear as mud.
Mm-hmm.
Wanted a little something else to go on.
So can you kind of look at that and see what we can have for next meeting?
Absolutely.
Anything else?
I'm done.
All right, good. That takes up number one on the next page, right? All right, Living Well reports. 3-2-24, 3-10-24, 3-17-24E. Any questions on that? Cheyenne, anything you want to add?
No.
Good. All right. Town manager report on budgets, expenses and budgets for currently at 67%, week 38, just about 73%. Any comments?
This is quite a process that I'm delving into here. So I appreciate your patience with me as I go through it. I've met with Library, Highway, Fire, the Lake Boston Rexon Association folks, and there are several other community groups that have asked also. But right now, as of today, the fiscal 24 budget is right around 66%, and we should be, based on the number of weeks in the calendar year, we should be at 73%, so we're holding tight, we're holding strong, as coming in overall under budget right now. Not necessarily by department, some departments may be a little over, but overall under budget.
All right, moving on. Okay, new business, we'll skip number one, we already did number one. Number two, a request to receive South Korean prayer ambassadors on behalf of the town of Madison.
This was I didn't quite know how to deal with this request, so I thought I would bring it to you all. Apparently, Frank Gleason with Somerset, pastor of Center Point Community Church in Anson, has received a group of South Korean missionaries, prayer people, and they want to be able to open it up to communities around Anson, just to say, hey, welcome, and we appreciate your prayers, basically. And it's not a matter of, you know, these people are moving in, they're doing this, they're doing that. This is strictly a spiritual mission for them. They want to be welcomed as prayer people.
Be a short term.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's like a 5-day visit or something.
I think they did that last year. I don't know if the board approved it.
If I have the authority, then I'll take care of it. But I didn't know if I happened to.
I think it just happened last year.
All right, number three. Muskie school internships between June and August of 2024.
Yep. So they have the ability to allocate college kids to towns for municipal experience at $18 an hour for a few months. And I think that this would be a really good use of funds for either TIF or ARPA. We have a balance of about $200,000 in ARPA for next fiscal year. And it would be something that I think would be really beneficial to help us. And one of the things that you had asked Mr. Moody was to get some kind of a plan to reorganize the office and find out where are we falling short, where is the greatest need. And I think this would be a helpful opportunity to come up with that plan.
How many people are we talking about to be involved, like in your office?
I would just ask one intern, but it may be an intern that goes to each of the people in the office,
right,
and saying, you know, help me identify the job duties that you think are the most time consuming and how we can help you with that.
Good.
So. Yeah.
Thank you.
So I would like to sign up for it, but I would like approval.
I would take it for it.
Do I need a motion on that one?
No.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Number four, appointed and elected positions expiring in June of 24. And we will appoint the.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Back up a minute. I think this is a cost factor. I think you do need a vote on that.
Okay.
I think it would be better.
All right. Let's
because
see.
We're using
okay.
funds.
Yep. So let me just give you a dollar number here. Just give me a second. 1.8 times 150. So $2,700.
Okay.
Plus.
I'm a little confused. So it says that they have the funds for that. And I'm pleased to write that the Muskie School has funding to support 6 internships.
Oh, okay, so yeah.
So it doesn't look like, I mean, I don't think that we have to pay for it.
Yeah, I kind of thought I read that.
Okay. I'll verify that.
Okay, we have, moving on, we have elected positions and appointed positions. We will appoint the appointed positions in June at our first meeting. No, I'm wrong. Our last meeting in June. Okay, I apologize. And so we have elected positions, and I believe you have a list of those in here?
Yes.
Okay, anybody interested? We need plenty of time to take out papers.
Dr. Cheyenne. There is one committee that is totally vacant committee, and I'd like to bring that one to your attention right now. That's the Solid Waste and Recycling Advisory Committee. And we have somebody in the audience that would like to, I'd like to introduce you to, that has expressed an interest in helping Madison get back on the recycling bandwagon.
All right.
May I do that?
Sure.
Beth and Bill, Vivian.
Yes, ma'am.
Would you care to speak to your the recycling?
Sure. So we're here today to ask the Select Board to take under consideration allowing Madison to form a committee to explore adding Madison back onto the recycling map. We understand that it's fallen off since the paper mill went out, and we would just like to have a committee formed, or at least have that explored.
Yeah, I mean, I think that committee's open. Let's fill it. And we should look for some people. We'll appoint them in June.
Okay.
You know, I don't think it's just the paper mill. I think it is the economics of it. At some point, things were going great guns, and we were money to be made. And then I think the bottom fell out. I mean, on it, how we do have people recycle at the Norwalk transfer station. So that is something that is happening. People who go there. So, but if that, by all means, if you want to look into that again, I think that that would be awesome.
Yep. And I would recommend that we get Paul Cannon involved in that, because he's one of the ones that brought it to our attention a few months ago.
How many people do we need?
It doesn't say. It just says all seats are vacant. So I don't know.
I think it was five. I'm not sure, but I think that originally it may have changed, but I think it was 5.
I think probably a hauler on that committee might be a good thing.
Okay.
I know at one point Chris Roy was on the committee, but I don't know if he still has interest in that.
Okay.
But I think, you know, it gives a perspective of what he collects.
Yep. I'll do that. I'll get those names.
Okay. And we can take it along with our last June meeting.
Yep.
So if you have anybody else that you want to get in on there, I give Denise your name just to make sure she has that.
Okay.
If both of you are interested, that'd be awesome.
Okay.
If she has that, so we can appoint them at that time, and then I would say start to get some ideas on what you want to do.
Absolutely. Thank you very much.
Yep. All right. Number 5, consideration of using .gov. Domain instead of .com for town website and email.
So there has been chatter in the management world about the security that's involved with the .gov domain. It would come under, it would be a subdomain of main.gov. So it would be like madison.main.gov. And one of the benefits, of course, is that it's absolutely identified as a municipal government or as a government entity, as opposed to .com, which typically references a business. So, and it would have some specific protections from the federal government, you know, security-wise.
Is there any cost to that?
I will need to research that.
Okay.
There would probably be a cost to transition, but I will find that out.
We'll just wait until you get that and we go to fix the budget for next year.
Yep.
All right, initial budget review.
Can I ask that we do the citizens' concerns first? Can we?
Well, you can. Citizens' concerns. Citizens' concerns? Chad?
Hope you ain't gonna wanna hear it, but what's the process of possibly doing an ordinance on preventing methadone dosing, suboxone dosing clinics in town?
Can I get your name, please?
Chad Drury, D-R-U-R-Y.
Thank you.
I don't have that information off the top of my head, but I think the town manager can probably get that information for you. I think that, you know, you have to go, I think getting that information from her probably would be the best way to go about it. Maybe the town clerk too. I'm not sure how exactly.
So the question is, what is the process to create an ordinance to prevent or prohibit? Okay.
So that's something you could stop in, Judd, and see her. And she can get you some, I mean, not tomorrow, but a day or two. And she can give you some information on how to go about starting that and getting it going. Does that make sense?
Before you leave tonight, can you just give me your contact information, please? Thank you.
John?
Would it be okay to ask if anybody else came to you with concerns about that?
You can ask that, and I could say, yes, they have. The issue that we're facing, and I didn't get your name.
John Martins.
Thank you. The issue that we're facing is that it's a private real estate transaction, and we have no authority to step in and prohibit that transaction. What we can do, I think, is make sure that whoever goes in there for business follows all the ordinances that we have on the books now. If we try to put a new ordinance in before they actually open the business, and it's an outpatient treatment facility, we may be facing a lawsuit for discrimination without an existing ordinance on the books already. So one of the things that we're looking into as a possibility, am I free to say this?
Sure.
Okay. Is the possibility of like a moratorium. So it gives us time to study the problem and to have public hearings and try to come up with a solution.
And I would hope that obviously this is being like done expediently to where we can get in front of it, to where we don't...
We're already way behind it. Because the real estate transaction is almost completed. So at this point in time, if one or the other of the real estate parties pulls out of the deal, then they could be facing fines and penalties and lawsuits themselves. We don't want to interfere with breaking a contract.
So one would have to think that we got something in place to set up a moratorium or a date that we're going to vote on?
I'm waiting for more information on that. And as soon as I get it, I will share that with the public, with the Board of Selectmen. Can I share that I had a conversation with Acadia?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. So I did have a conversation with somebody from Acadia Health that is going to be operating the clinic, the outpatient treatment clinic, and they are willing to come and be presented with these questions and these concerns by the citizens. So, and have an opportunity to have this discussion with you and any other concerned citizens. So they're trying to get their calendar figured out so that we can make that happen as soon as possible.
I understand. With all due respect to you as well, I think that somebody should take the lead on this and get it going, like, to where we're not waiting to have these meetings with them. We have our own agendas here, so we should push the forefront of our agenda and getting that moratorium in place. Even before meetings, before anything, try to get it all set up to where we're already expressing our views as a community about our sentiments.
So So you'd like to see a public hearing?
I don't know how the process goes. I love the process, but I...
I don't think you can do that unless you have a plan. Unless they provide us with a plan and nothing has come to you. So there's no plan. We don't have anything. So you can't just assume without something written. And it's always been, we've been very reluctant to set up rules in town. We want very minimal type rules. And so that, when this, something like this happens, it causes your grief right now.
Sure.
And so it's hard. I mean, because you should have been talking about this years ago. But you never thought that would happen. And you gotta remember that there are people who aren't opposed to something like that too.
Of course, I understand.
So, if you can stop in and see her and we can see how we can get it going, I mean, I it's not going to be a quick process, because that's not the way government rolls. You do know that, I think.
Sure, I do know that.
Because we got to get everybody's thoughts, everybody's what they're thinking before sure. You can make those decisions.
And of course, I sit here and so many other people sit here with their own opinions about
yes.
What's going to happen
yep.
Potentially there.
Yep.
But I just don't want, like you said, the closing to take place and all of a sudden they're going to start throwing legal jargon at us to where it ties our hands to where we can't do anything as a town. So
yep.
I don't know how we're going to go about doing it, but I really think we need to stay on point on this and not put it on a back burner and just have somebody roll
it in
the
right direction.
It is not on the back burner.
Anything else?
Anybody on
this,
on the web, Zoom, had any citizens' concerns? Peter or Robin?
Nope.
Anybody else? Any citizens' concerns? Yes, Tammy.
I was just wondering, is there anything going on at the highway department that we can't get the roads plowed and cleaned up? The trucks broke down, lack of staff, I mean, what's...
Can you give me some examples what you mean? You can't get the roads plowed?
Cleaned up Main Street, there's no parking. The side roads here are caved in more than normal.
I would say that tonight they will be cleaning up Main Street, I would assume.
They are. The plan is for them to go out at midnight.
That's what I was expecting to have happen. I expected it kind of last night, but
yeah,
that didn't happen. So we've got to move on with that.
If I may?
Yep.
The two people in particular in the highway department worked more than 30 hours straight. Trying to get the roads so that they were passable, safe, and as clear as possible. And so they were not in a position last night where they could clear the sidewalks and the banks and everything else. They just, I mean, it was 30 inches of snow in a day and a half, so that it was just, it's not a reasonable expectation to think that they'll go for 30 hours just to clean the streets and make sure that they're safe and passable to turn around then and be able to pick up all the extra snow that's on the side. They were working on that this morning and they are coming back in at midnight to clean up as much as possible, and then they'll continue that tomorrow and the day after. But when it comes to Main Street and some of the Old Point Avenue, Weston Avenue, they have to wait until there's virtually no traffic before they can clean those streets, clean the extra banks off the sidewalks. Does that answer your question?
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Denise, are you telling me that we have people on the road crew that are working 30 straight hours?
They did during this storm. They took rest, but they clocked in and they essentially didn't clock out until another 30 hours because they had to stay on it until the storm was done.
I understand that. But we're getting kind of on a fine line with OSHA here, because if something happens because they're overtired, the town is liable for that.
Right, and that's why they took rest periods. They took a half hour or an hour rest period every so often. There were periods of time when the visibility was so low that they were parked on the side of the street and they couldn't plow because they couldn't see. So they were using that time to rest also.
I understand. I'm just curious and about, you know, anybody working extended hours without breaks.
They did take breaks.
Because it makes the town liable if there's any type of an incident or an accident.
We're also down one person, correct?
We're down one person as of this morning.
Well, we were down during the storm.
Yes, we were down another person due to injury.
Okay, any other slides? Yes, sir.
I'm just wondering what your force is, you know, as far as the trucks and the men that clean the streets, you know, like in a snowstorm. Do they normally handle a normal storm, but not something like this, obviously?
Yes.
But what is the workforce within the public?
We have a road commissioner, we have a foreman, we have four other people? Three other people?
Cody, Nick, Peter, and Haas, and another Peter. Yeah, so there's five other guys.
Five people.
Five plus the foreman plus the road commissioner.
Yep.
So should somebody be looking into how many miles of road you have to plow and how many miles of sidewalk? And is the crew that you have adequate enough to do that? Or is it at a point where you're going to have to add people on this crew? I'm sure, like our side street, Earl Street, was a mess. But I'm sure they were trying to clean the main drags, keeping the main drags.
Yes.
I have no complaints about this last stone and some of the others I do, as far as the sidewalk. So it almost sounds like to me that there's not enough people doing the job. I don't know, I just moved here a couple of years ago, so I don't know. But the gentleman there is correct. These guys working 30 hours at a stretch, and if something happens, the town of Madison's going to be liable. And they're not going to go along with the fact that the guy stopped for a half an hour for a rest. They're not going to go along with that. A lot of municipalities now they have a place where the guys sleep, and they have to have so many hours sleep before they can back out on the road. It's just something you have to look at.
Yes.
It's the way it is.
Thank you. Any others?
Yes.
Yes. We live on a road that's on Oak Street and crosses Spruce Street.
Yep.
And in the morning, that is like a bucket. We have buses stop. We have two buses that stop, and then children are coming out, and it's terrible.
You're saying Myrtle Street this way?
Yeah, they cut across.
Yes, and I don't know if they're coming up out down. There's a loop that comes around. But there's like a couple vehicles, and they're doing 45 or so on that road in the morning. And the same way at night, it's like a racetrack.
At one time, going all the way across there, there were stop signs at every corner.
There is, but they don't stop.
No, I'm saying going this way.
Right.
Those are all gone now, I believe, right? Yeah, those are gone. So it was facing this way, you'd come to it and stop. So maybe we need to talk about putting those back.
Do you know what the speed limit is on those side streets like that?
25.
And that's just automatically. You don't need a speed limit sign for that. People should know it's 25.
Yep.
That's the law.
Yep. Well, maybe we can get the sheriff to get out and patrol down there a little bit more.
Do you have any description or anything of the vehicles that you've seen severely speeding?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
There's one white pickup. I don't know the name of that.
7:15 every morning coming down through there. I can take pictures of
it. Would you?
Yeah, would you?
Yeah.
Yeah, please. Yeah, you would. That would be awesome.
Oh, yeah.
So we might be able to get the flashing speed sign, and get a deputy down there to just kind of sit.
Yeah, because sometimes people don't know what the speed limit is, but that's, they're going way too fast.
You're in an area with a lot of houses, and you kind of should know what the speed limit is.
You should.
I apologize, but.
And then there are other people that are beautiful.
Yeah.
So So between 7 and 7:30?
Yeah.
And what time at night?
It varies. Yeah, between 3:30, 4 o'clock, something like that, 4:30.
3:30 to 4:30?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Yes.
I got, who would I, would I talk to Mike about adding like a crosswalk somewhere, or would it be you guys?
I would say right there, start with.
And it's only, it's my experience only. I don't know, maybe other people have experienced this, but coming by the junior high school, we got that crosswalk that's right there by, right on the sidewalk on this side of the parking lot. I drive my kids to school every morning, and a lot of the kids will use that crosswalk, but I'm noticing probably 30-40% of the kids cut across right in front of Dunkin' Donuts and hit the parking lot right after it. So, and I tell my wife every morning, I was like, one of these kids are going to get smoke coming through there.
There is a crosswalk right at Dunkin' Donuts, just below Dunkin' Donuts. Yeah, not that far. No, it's on that corner. There's
yeah,
a crosswalk right on that corner.
Is there?
Oh, Pleasant Street.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I get we try to educate our kids to use crosswalks and stuff, but those kids just go right across there, and I didn't see a crosswalk there.
Yeah.
But I think I know what you're talking about. It's down closer to the church, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, those kids got to figure out how to cross right there instead.
Good luck.
Yeah, right.
All right, any other questions? Okay, moving on. We'll go back to the initial budget review.
Okay.
Is that in my pocket?
Nope. It's still in my head. The initial budget review essentially is we're looking at the 4 to 5% increase almost across the board. Some things may stay flat, but most everything is going to go up. Personnel services, the road. Highway is 4% by contract this year, so probably the town staff should receive the same. The big ticket items are, Highway is looking to purchase another truck, and it's already been ordered, and it's supposed to be, it was ordered last year, and it's supposed to be coming in July or August. And we have the money for that, that's not a problem, but we need $100,000 for the wing and the plow to go on that truck. So that's going to be one of the things that we're going to be asking, big ticket item. Another big ticket item is the highway also wants to purchase an excavator, and they think that that'll be about $150,000. And I've had conversations with the road commissioner that why is it more prudent to buy an excavator than it is to rent as you need it. So that's a discussion that's ongoing, and I apologize, that's why that's not ready. The library is going to be, again, everything is going to be close to 5%. I ran out of time and I don't have the paperwork in front of me, so I apologize for that.
We can get that before the next meeting.
Absolutely.
Yeah. We should have that to take a look at before.
Absolutely. Yep. I will get it to you within by Friday.
Okay.
Denise, you're talking about the overall budget.
The overall budget, yeah. So, and
4 to 5%.
Yes. So the overall budget from last year, let me go back to my calculator, was 3.9 million. So if we take 3.98 million times 1.05, we're looking at about 4.2 million. And some of that can come from TIF, some of it can come from ARPA, some of it can come from taxation.
Yeah.
And some of it can be cut too.
And some of it can be cut, yes.
Okay.
Yes, yes. It's not a bottom line hard and stone number. I do have the Lake West Runset folks here that would like to talk about theirs. Request is for an extra, their request this year was $5,500 that's in the budget, and then next year for fiscal 25, they're asking for $15,000 so that they can increase the number of hours on the courtesy boat inspection people that are working. Eric and Mark can speak to that, but they had a recent episode where somebody came in from Massachusetts with four boats. They launched pre-dawn, and when they came back out, there was an invasive plant that was found on their boat. So, you know, this is an effort to prevent the invasive species and to eliminate remediation down the road. So, did you guys want to add anything to that?
Can I ask you a question? Is there any way that you can control launching those boats prior to daylight, you know, to get them inspected somehow, or have some type of notice for arrangements? If you want to go pre-dawn, have your boat checked out the day before. You know, even if it takes an ordinance or something, because, you know, and I feel bad if that lake out there gets that darn stuff or any other stuff that's in there, because you'll never stop it once it gets going. Not unless you reclaim the whole lake, and if you do that, you ain't going to have any fish left.
Yeah, you're absolutely right as far as stopping it once it gets started. And you wouldn't be looking at like 15,000, we'd be looking at like 15 million probably.
Right.
Totally eradicate a major infestation. I'm not sure if we could, if the town can limit access to a state water.
Could you look into that and see what the legalities are and what the restrictions are of maybe possibly doing something of that nature to prevent this? And I know the state's all for, you know, stopping milfoil and all that, and I feel that they probably would, you know, give you some good considerations on how to control that somehow.
Legally. The only case that I know of where the state has closed a launch has been in the Belgrade several years ago, probably 15 years ago,
yep,
when they got the infestation.
Yep.
And that created a firestorm.
You couldn't.
Remember
you couldn't,
hearing about that?
You couldn't close that from sunset to sunrise.
I don't know. Yeah, that's a good question.
To me, somebody coming in the pre-dawn hours and going into the lake. I mean, I don't. That doesn't sound right to me.
Denise, would you check with our attorney to see what legally we have control?
Because, I mean, sunset in the summertime is 8:15 or so.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you're,
yeah,
you know, I,
right.
Or I mean, unless we have somebody there. I mean,
you know, like I said, maybe we can come up with an ordinance if it's legal to say that if you're going to launch your boat, you know, before dawn, then you need to have it pre-inspected the day before.
I don't know the solution. Frankly. It's
you check into it. We'll check into it.
Yeah, we're looking at expanding the number of hours and bringing someone in.
Sure.
And particularly, what we're seeing is groups of fishermen, particularly from Massachusetts, Rhode Island, New Jersey, half a dozen of them, three or four, will come up here with a group of boats. They'll stay at a motel. They'll fish every lake in central Maine over the course of a week or so. And it creates, in my opinion, a huge hazard of importing something from one of the infested lakes or rivers around our area.
Right.
And if we can expand our inspections to catch that early morning, put someone on at 6 o'clock, say.
You're still going to have that 10% no matter what you do. And that 10% is the percent that's going to kill your lake.
Yeah. Anything else?
I guess I'd like to add that
that's Lake Western Association mission, is the protection of the public resource that is Lake Western Onset. And we've run the courtesy boat inspection program since 1999. The town took it over for a few years early on, but then we took it back, and the town's been subsidizing that program since. What's happened is, since the pandemic, when the use of Lake Western Onset shot up, because everybody wanted to go out on their own, they didn't want to go to public places that were crowded, we've seen the numbers climb of boat launches every day, and we've seen invasive species move closer. They're in the Kennebec River below Skowhegan, which is less than 10 road miles away from East Madison boat launch.
Right.
And that's how invasive species are transmitted, is boats carrying them from one water body to the other. Norridgewock's in the same boat with no oil and no stream.
Have you thought about a gate?
We have kind of tossed around ideas like that, and we think one of the issues with putting up a gate to control the access at different times of the day is you're just going to push people around to, like, Abnaki. For a fee instead. There's got to be answers, but we haven't gotten deep enough in it to see how you could really make it work. Captain?
What is the hours that you have somebody here at the doing the inspections right now?
It varies. We try to schedule people in peak hours, concentrating on, say, Friday through Sunday on the weekends, and then warm afternoons, so we don't have a set schedule always. And what we really need to do is to start, have someone there every morning, I think, during the prime season, and hopefully catch some of these guys. The screw that came in last year, it probably came in around 6 o'clock in the morning. I don't remember exactly. I remember hearing them come through and watch the boats, and they were out on the pond, and I went over around 8 o'clock and looked at the trailers, and every single trailer had aquatic plants on it. Not necessarily all invasive, but nonetheless, it's illegal to carry aquatic plants. I photographed the trailers, I photographed the license plates, and the boat inspector was on in the afternoon, and we intercepted them when they came back in and inspected their boats when they came out. By the way, they were quite nonchalant about the whole thing. Yeah, what do you guys bother with this for anyway? You're going to get it anyway. You know? They'd obviously hadn't maintained their boats. I checked the live wells, and I found plants in the live wells. We sent all the samples we collected to the state. They were identified. They identified one as being fanwort, which is an invasive that hasn't yet been found in Maine. That was good news. And since that time, DEP got involved with it. The Water Service got involved with it, and this winter, one of the warden investigator went to Massachusetts and served summons on all these folks. And we're hoping that something will come of that, and then we'll publicize it. Which, you know, that sometimes having that, the word out that, yeah, you can get caught and you can get a fine. Minimum fine's $500, you know, can go up to $5,000. So, that's kind of what precipitated our increased concern, is these characters. But
I'm just curious, if your inspector, you know, somebody comes in with their boat and the inspector finds something on their boat or their trailer, or whatever, do you turn them away? Or how do you handle that?
We would make sure that if we found something on their boat and trailer, we would record it. Collect it, and make an attempt to determine if it was an invasive. But
once their boat has been inspected, this is going in, and they're clean after we've collected anything that might be on the trailer, then they can, they're free to go in into the lake. And by the way, by the law that establishes boat inspections, we do not have direct enforcement capability. Someone can come in and refuse to be inspected and put their boat in, and we can't do a thing about it except note on our inspection sheet that they are uncooperative and refuse inspection. So yeah, this holds all through this process.
Definitely.
You give credit to the boaters; most of them are perfectly willing to have the boats inspected, and they're very polite and cooperative. But there's a, like you said, a few.
Oh yeah.
All right, anything else?
So with this increase, that would be enough then? The increase that you're looking for, that would be enough to have somebody there to cover all the hours that you think that they need?
That should give us, say, what, 60 hours a week, you figured?
Yep. It's close. Mm-hmm. We don't think that's the answer.
Right.
We think more hours are needed, but we've been ramping up since 2019, which when we tried to do 30 hours a week. And last year we got to 48 hours a week. So mm-hmm. we're kind of increasing as we can.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. The other factor that's hit us over the last few years is the increase in wages.
Mm-hmm.
Not only just the increase in minimum wage, but the difficulty in finding someone who will work for minimum wage.
Right.
We've had to pay over that to get the people.
Thank you. All right, select board concerns.
Chairman Manzano, there is one other citizen concern that I failed to include, and that's Mr. Pike is here to talk about, help me out.
I just got a housing proposal. I'm actually looking to, my name's Scott Pike, I'm looking to move to Madison. My daughter lives up on White Schoolhouse Road. She moved here last year, bought a piece of property. I live in Waterville, Maine right now. I've been working on a panelized housing project for about 15 years. I have run into a lot of walls. No one really wants to deal with the housing issue. I've gone through, I started out in Waterville because that's where I live right now. I am trying to adapt a program that can be presented anywhere in the country. The panels that I'm proposing that we start building are 4x8 and smaller, so they're not big panels. They can be built in a garage by normal people, you know, with common materials. I have gone all the way to the state legislature department, and just no one wants to address the issue. We're in a major housing crisis right now, and we need 80,000 units of housing right now just to take care of Maine. And there's just not 80,000 housing units to take care of that right now. And I'm looking at Zero Winter Street. I'm not sure if y'all are familiar with the property. It's large enough and it has issues. And I love lands with pieces of issues because I really want to make this a community project. I'm working with local shelter systems to develop a program where we can have people that are in need of housing help develop the product. I'm suggesting that we build 12 by 16 ADUs, which meets the new ADU policy in the state of Maine. And I want to put a jig up, and that's my first concern for the city of Madison. I would like to place a 12 by 16 jig up, a place to build off from, so that I can have a system that our local code enforcement can inspect. And I'm working with the state code enforcement already. I've already talked to them about the system that I'm proposing to build, so that we can work on housing, you know? I mean, that's kind of what it's all about.
So I guess I'd advise you to talk to our code enforcement officer and our planning board. That's the process I would say you're going
to
be going.
Oh, absolutely. No, I want to have, I'd love to have you all involved. I just kind of wanted to meet y'all. You know what I mean?
All right.
You know, and I get involved in your community, and I got business cards, and I got a video out, just kind of a little about me.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, go ahead.
Honorable set, thank you.
Moody?
Good.
All right, I'm good. All right, looking for a motion to go into executive session, discuss personnel matter pursuant to 1 MRSA 4056A.